I have a romantic existence.
Tonight, the life and times of Tom Jackson.
You watch your friggin' mouth, Rosie, or I'm going to drive you one.
Actor, musician, humanitarian, and entrepreneur. What drives the man? Good evening, I'm Gordon Pinsent. Each December, Tom Jackson travels across Canada performing the Huron Carol Concert. It's a celebration of Christmas and a carol of hope for the needy. In 10 years, his concerts have raised millions for charity. Today, Tom Jackson is a star in the hit series North of 60, but he grew up in a one-room shack and spent his teenage years living on the street. As you'll see in tonight's documentary, broadcast earlier this year, Jackson had an experience one night that changed his life. He decided he wanted to make a difference.
You watch your friggin' mouth, Rosie, or I'm gonna drive you.
That's not all I do for you.
Was that the way they do it in China?
He's quite a talent. I mean, he can sing and play guitar and write songs and act and do a number of things. When he goes up and does the concerts in Northwest Territories and places like that, he gets mobbed. It's just Tom Jackson's in town. It's like Mick Jagger strode in from somewhere, you know?
They're like blessings never seen.
The women are just in love with Tom.
I think he's extraordinarily sexy.
Yes, he's a good actor. Yes, he's a very good musician. But he's a tough businessman. He's not a guy I'd like to negotiate a contract with. He's very tough horse trader.
You got any shoes?
He loves to plot. He loves to plan. He's always thinking big. He is like a little tornado. It touches down. He just sends off this whirling swirl of activity.
Lift your eye to the eagle cry.
He's also very much the humanitarian.
I'll talk to him.
He knows the agony on the edges of society, and he addresses it. He hasn't forgotten. He hasn't abandoned that part.
All you gotta do is have a family. I like walking that line. It's a romantic life. Being a bit of a rogue, you know, and it's the gambler. It's the guy who does things on stage. It's the guy who travels around the world, you know. I have a romantic existence.
Ladies and gentlemen, Tom Jackson.
The blizzard back in 1965.
The Huron Carol, the glory of Christmas seen through native eyes. A song that has become the signature of Tom Jackson's soul, performed each December, with all proceeds going to charities. An expression of love from a street smart veteran who gives far more than he takes.
What I am skilled in is my knowledge of the entertainment business. So I use that as a vehicle to change the world. If you're going to invest in something, do something that you know. What I know is what I've learned on the street, in the pool halls. And the world out there is not so different than that.
Thomas Dale Jackson was born tiny and premature on the back of a horse-drawn buckboard in rural Saskatchewan in 1948. When he was an infant, he was bitten by a rabbit, an incident that his elders read as a sign of a long life. His mother, Rose, was Cree. His father, Marshall, an Englishman cast adrift in the years following the Second World War.
At the time that my mom and dad were together, mixed marriages were not exactly looked upon in favor, even though that my dad lived on the reserve, you know, accepted by the native community, but I don't think my mom was accepted necessarily in the non-native community as well as he was accepted on the other side. But hats off to my dad for going that way. But to watch my dad and my mom together was, you know, just watching royalty. Like, just amazing to see those two together. Because they're so distinct in their personalities. My mother was very outgoing. My father was very reserved. You'll pardon me for the word.
In a one-room shack on the One Arrow Reserve, Tom and his older sister, Marlene, grew up without electricity or running water as their father searched unsuccessfully for work.
We couldn't afford to rent anywhere else. We didn't have any money. No job. One stove in the middle of the room. Beds around the wall. Yeah. It was nothing nice to look at. It was a plate of roof over your head.
The family moved to Saskatoon, where Marshall Jackson was hired as a railway brakeman. They lived for a while in the foundation of an unfinished house. Tom was six.
Me and my sister used to go along the track to pick up the coal off the side of the train. Is that poor? I don't think that's poor. I think it's a passage of life somewhere in there. Bad planning? Doesn't make you poor. It makes you rich, you know? I'm sure that someplace along the way, some of that gets romanticized in my memory, and it's not quite that way that it went. But to me, that's sort of where all my comfort zone is. You know, it's maybe the comfort is in the struggle. I don't even know. You know, maybe I'm uncomfortable in some ways with this position of success.
3 years later, they moved to the Namao Air Force Base near Edmonton, where Marshall found work as a leading air craftsman. Tom and Marlene stood out as the only native children on the base. Tom was called chief by the other boys. Marlene remembers the sting of their separateness.
I saw prejudice there. I know there was physical fights. We'd sometimes come home crying and, you know, beat up or whatever.
My famous nickname was Canindian. I was Canindian. It was an identification for me, you know. It didn't bother me at the time. Never, you know, none of that bothered me. Somebody was, because in some ways, I guess it was, maybe it was done and said with a malicious intent, but I didn't read it that way when I was a kid. I didn't understand a lot of that stuff and what it meant or where it came from. You know, I didn't understand what the implications of that were and how it affected other people.
Rose Jackson did understand. In an era when Native people were expected to accept their place at the bottom of Canadian society, she instilled pride and self-reliance.
When she would talk to me, it would be just basically, you know, you're no different than anybody else. You know, you're just as good as. And the only problem is you have to be a little stronger and you have to try a little bit harder.
Marlene did try harder. She became one of the best baton twirlers in the world, and the joy of her performances lit a spark in her baby brother's heart.
And I remember looking at that and I went, boy, I'd like to do that someday, you know. Because I was, you know, I can remember the feeling that I wanted to be on that stage someday in that kind of a situation. You know? But I was certainly in admiration of what she was doing. I was always in awe of my sister. And I mean, that's great, you know. Oh yeah, my sister's a wonderful girl. She's a wonderful person. I love her a lot. My point is that my mother's and father's life, in a lot of ways, were focused around what became a public life for my sister. So mine was very independent. You know, I was very independent. I was a happy kid living without rules almost, you know.
At the age of 9, Tom started to play guitar and found his own voice.
Charlie found a nightlight, and morning found a food. Learning all the lessons, boy,
Tom was 15 when the Jacksons moved again, this time to Winnipeg. Suddenly, his world was spinning on a new axis. When he was cut from the grade 10 basketball team because of poor grades, he left school and home. Lured by the scent of adventure and the comradeship of other native youths.
I grew up in a church. I was going to be a priest. And I got to Winnipeg, and life was a lot different. And a lot of the things that I'd grown up with in school that I thought was run-of-the-mill, this is the way life was, I found out from my brother Bernie when I met him. That's not the way life was. You don't go around allowing people to call you chief all your life. That's not the way life is.
Bernie Henry was an older native boy who became Tom's idol and surrogate sibling. A naive newcomer's guide to survival in the tough North End.
Back in the 60s, you would have called him looking a little square. Quiet, almost unsure. So I think I sort of took Tom as my brother under my wing type thing, and we looked after each other.
Tom worked where he could, as a shipper, even skinning minks. And he slept in the parks, stairwells, and boxcars, wherever it was warm. Bernie and the big guy, as Tom was known, haunted the backstreet hotels, and Bernie Henry taught Tom Jackson how to make a living with a pool cue.
You always made sure you had a dollar and a quarter in your pocket so you could put 25 cents in the pool table and a dollar to gamble with. I would say we were players looking to survive, to put something in our stomachs and have a little fun. And if that meant winning $60 and partying all night, and that's what we did.
The boys played billiards, poker, shuffleboard, backgammon, even chess. In the rituals of games, the hustle, the bluff, the victory, Jackson discovered the skills and strategies that would help shape his life.
When I play to win every game. If a player was better than me, I would not play him. But I had a reasonable skill at being able to read my opposition and picking my opposition. If I'm negotiating a big contract, I can read the guy across the table from me as well as I could read the guy across the table in the pool hall.
But they're few and far between. They're like blessings never seen. They're like visions in a dream.
But then came a time when Tom Jackson made the wrong move, trusted the wrong people, and paid a painful price.
I got arrested once for an attempted break and an enter. Which didn't have a hell of a lot to do with me, but it doesn't matter. I ended up going to jail for a short period of time. And in that period of time, I had to sit in an interrogation room. And I got racked off the walls by a detective. And then they covered that up by putting me in another cell. So, and they doctored stupid things, which really, none of that's important. What is important was that in the experience, I went, no, I don't think so. I don't care what it was I was doing or not doing to get me into the situation. This was not going to be my cup of tea. I didn't want to do this. And to this day, I swear that if I had not had that experience, and if this detective had not done what he did, I'd be in jail.
With his life in the balance, Tom was taught by a Winnipeg folk singer named Graham Jones how to channel his energy into the passion of a song.
He basically said to me that I should do something with my life. And, I was a pretty smart-ass kid at the time. I remember his name. But, like what? And he said, what do you want to do? And I said, well, why don't you show me how to play guitar? So he jumped on it and said, yeah.
But man himself decided.
In 1971, Tom recorded a song called White Man Listen. He earned $375 and bought his first professional guitar. Menno Weeb was on the board of a Native youth drop-in center that became Tom's second home.
There's a lot of difficulty, a lot of lonely people in the city of Winnipeg, many of them Native. And these kids found their way into this drop-in center, and Tom had a way of being the magnet. Tom Jackson can be portrayed as the optimist. He saw daylight ahead of the problems, and I think that's what attracted the kids to him. With all their loneliness and their depression, they saw something in Tom that he didn't get stuck with the problems.
For $75 a month, Tom found a room at the Royal Albert Hotel. It was all he could afford, but his generosity was deeper than his poverty.
I really can't remember a time now that he wasn't helping someone. He'll give you his last dollar when he was younger. He'd come home without a jacket because he gave it to someone. You know, that sort of thing. He'd be bringing people home because he didn't know them. He'd just because they needed a meal to warm up.
My mother always emptied her pockets on the street. And she didn't have very deep pockets. She was this woman who, you know, I guess maybe not unlike me in some ways, that got joy out of doing things for other people.
And whenever he brought anybody home at Christmas, the turkey was always bigger than we needed because she knew he was going to bring somebody home. And there was always unmarked gifts under the tree. Always, you know, a scarf, a pair of mitts, socks, whatever. And everybody that came for Christmas dinner had left with a gift.
Was in the moon of winter time when all birds had fled.
It is in those years of scraping for survival that today's Huron Carol concerts have their roots. The song itself was written in the 17th century in the Huron language by Jesuits to teach the story of Christmas. For Tom, the tradition began in 1971 when he assembled 45 Native kids to sing the carol in a pageant called Manitou Christmas.
It had some of those ingredients of what Tom wanted to bring forward. We are in the picture. We are not adjuncts to what happens in our country. We have a place on the stage, as it were, to use that metaphor.
But for many Native North Americans in the early 70s, there was more than music in the air. At Wounded Knee, South Dakota, a standoff between militants and the U.S. government became the touchstone of a fierce new Native pride. Tom Jackson and Bernie Henry found their world shaken and their identity challenged.
Someplace along the way, we asked each other if, in fact, it came to a life and death situation, would we put ourselves on the line for being Indian? And I called Bernie, and we sat down, and I said, okay, here it is. What are you going to do? He said, what are you going to do? I said, well, I don't know. You want to go? Like a lot of other things in our lives, we said, I'll go if you go.
It was a bit more than we expected. You have all the powers of the American government against, you know, a little group of maybe 200 people. And you have the entire military might of the U.S. government looking you in the eye, and that's frightening.
We're willing to die, but not willing to kill. And decided at the end of it all that there had to be another way to create change. If you wanted to create change, this was not necessarily the best way to do it.
A Fall from Grace, when Life and Times returns.
At Altamira, we have an industry term for all the RSP information you need. The kit. It guides you through all of our 27 no-load mutual funds. And with our help, you can make the RSP choices that are right for you. And it's absolutely free. So call Altamira at 1-888-NO-LOADS for your free RSP investment kit. We have an industry term for that, too. SMART. Altamira. Helping you take control.
Another Nokia discovery. Small words are hard to read, which is why at Nokia, we make wireless phones with screens that are big, so they're easier to read. Inspired technology with a human touch. Nokia. Connecting people.
He's taken you to thrilling emotional heights. Now, Michael Burgess, the acclaimed star of Les Miserables, releases his debut album. A Place in the Sun features five exceptional new songs and magical versions of well-known favorites. A passionate performer whose stunning voice is thrilling audiences across Canada. Michael Burgess, in stores now or call toll-free.
Modesty Entertainment presents The Celtic Collections. Enjoy the depth and power of Celtic music from the leading Irish artists of today. Look for the Celtic Collections display in stores now.
With activism at Wounded Knee, convinced Tom that the most potent weapon at his command was his guitar. He sang of Native identity and Native confidence.
Never been with a large group of musicians in my life until I started playing folk festivals, and I realized how much you could learn. Like 3 days with three 300 musicians, that all of a sudden you realize that what you know, you kind of want to go, maybe I'll sit back on this one. But you get to hear great players and you learn stuff.
Never knew anybody, baby, to turn my head around.
Oh, I wanted to be the Doors. I wanted to be Jim Morrison. You know, I wanted to be the Beatles. I found out quickly, though, that, well, maybe not with Jim Morrison, but certainly found out that guys with a vocal range like mine don't get to sing rock and roll. I discovered folk music, which was great.
I never knew anybody made my heart thunder.
Support from his family never wavered. His mother, Rose, attended every concert, every coffee house.
She wanted me to sing all the time. So we had tapes, kitchen tapes. My mom used to, you know, those old Sony things, tape recorders. I'd come over and she'd always want me to sing. Sit in the kitchen, I'd sing songs and she'd push the tape button. So she must have a log of those things that she took with her when she went to heaven or wherever people go. She took them with her. I miss her dearly.
I got the love bullet, babe. I got the love song. Do me right, cause I got nothing going.
In the 70s, the singer and songwriter Pshin Goose joined Tom in a renaissance of Native identity as Canada began to discover the eloquence of voices it had always ignored.
We were just around at the time when it was starting to happen. I mean, if you look back, it was only in 1952 that the Indian Act was repealed to the point where Indian people were allowed to express themselves once again. And it took another 20 years after that before people actually did start expressing themselves, because they were still locked into that old mentality of say nothing, do nothing, just follow orders and get your handouts type of thing. And that. But, you know, as we started evolving socially, economically, that brought about a whole new era or a time when people could start expressing themselves intellectually, spiritually.
I want the whole store. That's right, the whole goddamn store.
30 days. Sure.
The breakthrough came in 1981 with The Ecstasy of Rita Joe, the first major play dealing with Native issues and with Native actors in Native roles.
30 days.
The grade 10 dropout was mesmerized by theater.
I had a copy of the album, The Ecstasy of Rita Joe, with Ann Mortifee singing it and Andrew's soliloquies and all that. I knew that soliloquy, all of those soliloquies, inside and out. That was one of my favorite records. I don't read that well, but I remembered it by memory.
Tom joined the cast and soon found that his acting talent was matched by his skill as a fundraiser. In Vancouver's business community, he gathered $100,000 in 2 weeks to take the show on tour. It was Tom's baptism as an actor.
It was a profound experience for me. And in some ways a greater understanding of things that I'd been asking questions to myself previous.
I think certainly it gave him renewed pride in his Native heritage, that's for sure. I also think that it opened up a world to him of expression that he reveled in. He had no idea that the theater could help him express himself the way it did. And he talks about that to this day, that was the beginning of a journey that he didn't expect.
I'm going up to Conklin. I got a job fighting fires.
Oh, gee whiz, the big time.
In Loyalties, his first film, Tom would earn a Genie nomination for Best Actor. He was hailed as a rising star, but he understood his own fragility.
Eddie, you go on, get out of here.
I'm not this vision of perfection as some people might think. I'm just not that person.
When Tom moved to Toronto in 1986 to further his acting career, he found himself once again drawn to the streets. In his own words, at times he indulged in illicit substances and was the architect of his own demise.
I just got into a lifestyle that was so inappropriate for what I believe I was meant to do. I was involved with people who did a lot of drugs. People who, the nightlife, which has always been a major part of my existence. Leads other people who want to just be associated with you into areas that they're not prepared to be in. And I'm not saying I was prepared to be in it, but I was prepared to leave it. But I just turned and ran. And I know that there's a lot of people who I may have influenced in that period of time. And it haunts me. Unbelievably haunts me. I have gone down a number of very dark corridors. And people have followed me down those dark corridors. And when I chose to turn around and come out, I left some people behind. And it's very important to know that I care about those people. And I will go and get them.
It was a descent into self-destruction. Then, one night he was walking home from a bar when he saw a huddled figure lying on the street, a figure everyone else was ignoring.
And as I got closer, I saw that this was an old man. And he didn't look scary to me, except that he was laying there and his eyes were wide open and he was staring at me, looking right through me. Cab came along, made him stop there, and made him call the emergency services. He'd had a cardiac and fallen down and broke his collarbone and And he turned out, he was okay. Turned out he was okay. But then I go back to this point. I didn't save his life, he saved mine. Because I could not imagine myself laying there without absolute horror, watching people go by. And I was laying there dying. It struck me so deeply that I had to change my whole life in order to accommodate what I wanted to do.
He decided to organize a Christmas concert to benefit a Native drop-in center, but he lost his entire down payment at Massey Hall when he couldn't sell enough advance tickets. Instead, the first Huron Carol concert took place at the Silver Dollar Room.
We did the first show. As much as we didn't raise any money on that night, the first Huron Carol, it was a grand evening. I did it hoping that there would be an observation out there that, oh, by the way, did you know that this guy was Native? Did you know that this guy would, with the hands going like this and say, here, this is yours, happens to be a Native? Well, and so I thought the name of the Huron Carol would help that.
It was 1987. Though hundreds of food hampers were collected, Tom was disillusioned and broke.
I'd phoned my friend Mike Stern, who was my gambling mate years ago, and told him I wanted to come home for Christmas and that I didn't have any money. And he borrowed it from his dad. He didn't have any money. I said, one way. Just got me a one-way ticket.
I can see the lights of the distant city. It seems I left it so long.
At home in Winnipeg, revived by friends and family, Tom organized a Christmas Eve dinner for the homeless. The only problem was convincing his guests to attend.
And we went out driving around looking for people, and it was very astonishing to actually believe people would get into the car with strangers. It's not like they know who I am. But unbelievably so, people got into the cars. But it's that first point of contact. Seemed like a good idea at the time, but can you imagine what it must have been like for these people to be driving, sitting in the back of the car, and all of a sudden there's a second thought, you know? And we'd have people that wouldn't get out of the cars. You know, we'd get them here, and they go, well, where are you taking me? A lot of them thought we were cops, taking them to jail. And some of them thought when we got here, they said, oh, you got the wrong people. We don't have any tickets for this. And my brother, who speaks or understands and speaks a little bit, and most of them were Native people, would say something to them. I don't know what the heck he said. You have to ask him. But then they'd laugh and they'd get out of the car.
I miss the wind in the chimney and the stars.
40 men and women would be fed that night at the old Royal Albert Hotel. It would become an annual tradition, a night of dignity, with no cameras and no reporters allowed.
I'll be home this Christmas.
We don't even know what we're doing, why we're doing it, other than we wanted to do something that represented Christmas, you know? But there wasn't one person in this mixture that did not stop and did not have tears in their eyes and did not shake our hands when they left here. That became an inspiration to me, to my friends, because you realize you could make a difference in somebody's life.
Walter Batuk lives at the Royal Albert Hotel.
He's got a big heart. There's no doubt about it. He knows where he was. He told me where he was. He was down on that street too, one time. And he remembers his roots. What it was like for him before he became a star.
A rising star, when Life and Times returns.
The Road to Excellence, presented by the Dairy Farmers of Canada and Royal Bank Financial Group. Kate Pace Lindsay, the 1993 downhill world champion, is eager to improve on her eighth place finish at the Lillehammer Games. In the late stages of her brilliant career, could Nagano be the well-deserved reward for this great skier? Kate Pace Lindsay, Alpine Skiing, Nagano Gold, Top 12. Canadian athletes, a source of pride for all Canadians.
Mina Dali. This cheese casserole looks delicious. Exquisite. A new recipe?
Well, I changed the mozzarella with Emmental, the Gruyere with Swiss, the Colby with Gouda.
When you change the cheese, you change the taste, giving your meals a whole new bite.
And then I added salt and pepper. Oh, and a clove of garlic.
Oh, when you've got cheese, you've got choice.
Together in one dynamite collection, Neil Young, Rita McNeil, Leonard Cohen, and Bob Dylan. Royal Canadian Air Force, back on top with Video Yearbook, Volume 4.
It's a miracle!
It's their greatest skits, reunited on one incredible video cassette.
Anyone crossing the border to leave Quebec would be shot.
And it's in stores now, man. Enter May the Farce Be With You contest at your nearest Blockbuster, courtesy of Canadian Airlines.
Got a dirty, filmy shower door? You've got a choice. You can try to scrub it, or you can CLR it. And that rust-stained bathtub? You can try steel wool, or you can CLR it. If you want fast and easy cleaning, try CLR. It's guaranteed to instantly remove the toughest stains caused by calcium, lime, and rust. CLR glass decanters. Quick and clean. CLR your pots and pans. CLR those water spot stains. And your toilet, too. CLR the stucco wall. Run a little through an empty washer cycle and get rid of rust stains in your machine. CLR works all over the house. It's guaranteed or your money back. So for tough stains in kitchens, bathrooms, basements, and more, the choice is CLR.
Available at participating Canadian Tire, Home Hardware, Kmart, Safeway, Zellers, Pro Hardware, Do It Centers, True Value Hardware, Beaver Lumber, Co-op Stores.
President's Choice TV.
I'm trying the Swiss milk chocolate bar. I love chocolate. This is great.
Product of Switzerland, so it's good for party chocolate.
It reminds me of another chocolate bar, which I'm not going to say the name. Good chocolate.
Introducing the President's Choice Swiss Milk Chocolate Bar with honey almond nougat, only $3.99.
Well, she hasn't said a word since it's been in her mouth, so it's got to be good.
I'm getting one from my mom. It's awesome. You got one?
Over 100 new President's Choice products in the Holiday Insider's Report.
In a sea of news programs, only one brings Canadians the whole story.
Good evening. Tonight's top story.
The National, tonight at 10 and 11 on CBC, Canada's most watched newscast.
Outstanding, extraordinary, a celebration of achievement. Bobby St. Marie and Jean-Pierre Ferland host an evening of tribute. The Governor General's Performing Arts Awards, Sunday, December 28th on CBC.
Through the ups and downs of his life, Tom has been married several times, has children and grandchildren. But he keeps his private life private. He finally found the peace he had always sought when he married Allison Jones, a Winnipeg businesswoman, in 1991.
Nobody knows where to go.
We became friends for a long time. And then we just fell in love, you know.
I felt there was a little arc around us that obviously had a lot of sparks, but I certainly felt very loved very early. I also felt very respected. There was definitely some heart, soul connection between he and I. And we were enthusiastic about a lot of the same things. We had similar goals and ideas, and we're very project-oriented people. We're very goal-oriented. We see something and let's do it, let's work on it, let's go that way.
For many years, I guess myself being driven to what I'm driven, that I ignored the rest of the world. And she brings the rest of the world to the party.
As his personal life gained stability and focus, Tom's acting career took off. On stage, television, And in films such as The Diviners, where he played the sultry Métis lover, Jules Tonnerre. In a children's series, he would star as Billy Two-Feathers.
Music can turn sadness into happiness. But there is something missing.
He would also host a Native Current Affairs show.
Welcome to First Nations. I'm Tom Jackson.
Ooh, what? You get that eye in Chirana? No, in Malawi.
Same thing happened to Floyd when he went to Montreal.
Malawi.
But the most enjoyable of all was when Tom starred in the comedy Medicine River, written by Native playwright Thomas King. Tom was perfectly cast as the trickster.
We don't want to be late.
What? Humor. They actually put humor in it. You know, we weren't all standing around going, The Native community is a very funny place. I always have sore ribs when I come away from spend some time with Tom.
That's the one project I had most fun on. That was most enjoyable. That's what I'd like to do more as an actor, just for my personal enjoyment, was to do goofy characters.
So,
if there's any role, if anything that I've done that is close to me, Harlan Bigbear is me.
Martha looked after Granny Pete's stuff when Granny died. Granny Pete, she married Jesse White Dog, and Jesse is Big John Yellow Rabbit's great uncle. That makes you cousins.
I don't believe we've actually had the pleasure of meeting. He's a very generous guy when it comes in front of the camera, and we both work well together, so that made some of the humor was there, but we were told to kind of tone it down a little bit. You know, this wasn't the Three Stooges minus one. It was just it was a humorous, sweet piece of story.
Not so you used to go.
Pardon? And we're always pulling jokes on one another in front of the camera. And that's a sense of brotherly love, I guess, with Tom. And the way I feel about this guy and the way I work with him.
Now, don't forget to explain why we're over budget.
You're not coming in?
No point in both of us trying to explain. Always gets confusing that way.
I remember when we first started out in the business, there was very limited roles available for anything, and it was always the sort of the stereotypical guys. Okay, ride over there on your horse, and when the gun goes off, fall on the ground and die. Oh, okay. How much are you going to pay me to do that? You know, that sort of thing. But as the years went on, that sort of changed because of a lot of kids were getting more education, more knowledge of the outside world, and so, hey, wait a minute, you know, this is not what it's like out here. Let us tell our own story. So, and like I said, through theater and people like Tom with high visibility on television every week, you know, so the kids are starting to say, well, why can't I do that?
In 1992, Tom landed the role that has made him a star, playing band chief Peter Kennedy on the CBC's North of 60. Filmed near Calgary with natives in most of the major roles, the series attracts 1.5 million Canadian viewers weekly and is syndicated around the world. But it is in Canada's native communities that Tom and Chief Peter have their greatest impact.
They're both leaders. They're both natural-born, leaders. And they're both heroes who understand that they are not perfect people. Tom's strength as a person and his success, I think, now comes out of knowing who he is, knowing how he got to where he is. The hard, long climb, the 1,001 steps. And what he brought to Peter Kennedy was the shadows, the dark spots, and the shadings that redeem that character from being a pompous politician.
Do you really want to appear like this on TV?
Like what?
Like sprawled on a couch?
Sprawled on a couch.
With a beautiful woman?
Tom believes that North of 60 helps bridge two cultures, the two nations that joined to create his own life
There's a process.
I believe that this show is a window into a community that you would not otherwise have. I believe it changes the opinions of people and how they look at Native people. We're not these weird animals in cages that are there for observation under pay of a dollar. We're human beings. And we have the same blood and the same care and the same love and the same hate that everybody else in the world has.
North of 60 is powerful drama. But many women watch the show because they think Tom Jackson is the sexiest man north of anywhere.
It was in the first season because we shot after Christmas. And I had got lost in the city here of Calgary, and I stopped this woman for directions, and I said, excuse me, could you tell me how to get here? And she goes, oh my God, you're on that show North of 60. And so, you know what I mean? I was just starting to be recognized. So I was like, yeah. And she says, oh my God, that Tom Jackson. I saw him at the Huron Carol. He sang this song about a steamroller. She says he could steamroll over me anytime. You tell him that. And I said, okay.
Looking up to Tom, like, in more ways than one. You know, for sure, I think that. That people can look and go, wow, he's did it right on, you know? I mean, he's a musician also, an actor, does stuff for the food bank and stuff. I mean, he's giving so much back into the community.
And now we're picking up.
In Peter Kennedy, the boy whose schoolmates called him Chief has finally found his identity as an actor and as a man.
But I myself, as an individual, I'm a half-breed. I'm locked in the middle of the world, and that world, I'm locked. Right in the middle of that, you know, and I take pride in being there, and I don't want to have to say I'm this and I'm that. I don't want to say that I'm not my father's son, and I don't want to say that I'm not my mother's son. So I'm happy right here.
I just passed a couple of pretty pissed off tourists. Something about
on Thursday nights on the One Arrow Reserve, Tom's extended family gathers for the most important hour of the week.
No, nobody.
I'm proud of him because he's an Indian like us in TV, and he's a movie man.
He is somebody to look up to. Like, I'm really, really proud of him. I have never said it to him to his face, but now you can show him. You know, I said I'm proud, and our whole family is proud.
Rose did not live to share her son's success, but his father carries the mantle of family pride.
He's gone a long ways on his own. I'm proud of him.
Charm, charity, and business. When Life and Times returns.
Seals have always been hunted here. But never like this. New Asian market demand for male organs as aphrodisiacs means carcasses left to rot. Commercial hunters charged with selling skins of protected pups. Others convicted for illegal weapons, even skinning a seal alive. This government-subsidized hunt kills mostly pups under a year old. Stop the subsidy. Stop the cruelty. Paid for by IFOF.
Together in one dynamite collection, Neil Young, Rita McNeil, Leonard Cohen, and Bob Dylan. Royal Canadian Air Force back on top with Video Yearbook Volume 4.
It's a miracle.
It's the greatest skits reunited on one incredible video cassette.
Anyone crossing the border to leave Quebec would be shot.
And it's available in stores now, man, or call 1-800-955-7711.
This is your TV. This is an ExpressView satellite dish. This is what happens when you put them together. All kinds of amazing channels bundled together by areas of interest. You never pay for the kinds of channels you don't want, like you do with cable. And with ExpressView's digital technology, you get picture and sound quality that's out of this world. So come on over to Better TV. ExpressView.
He's taken you to thrilling emotional heights. Now, Michael Burgess, the acclaimed star of Les Miserables, releases his debut album.
A Place in the Sun features five exceptional new songs and magical versions of well-known favorites. A passionate performer whose stunning voice is thrilling audiences across Canada. Michael Burgess. In stores now or call toll-free.
This holiday from Eaton's, discover the romantic fragrance L'Air du Temps and receive absolutely free the three-piece gift set.
From director Steven Spielberg, Jeffrey Lyons calls Amistad unforgettable. Rolling Stone says Anthony Hopkins is sensationally good.
What this case concerns is freedom, the very nature of man.
And Siskel and Ebert give Amistad two thumbs up. Morgan Freeman, Anthony Hopkins, Jaimin Hansu, Matthew McConaughey. Amistad.
Now playing at a theater near you.
This holiday from Eden's, discover the famous fragrance Dolce & Gabbana for men or for women and receive absolutely free this signature t-shirt.
We have done what they said was impossible.
We're on our way.
We did it.
I'm going to push this plane today and it could be dangerous.
This whole thing's a big mistake.
They're trying to shut us down.
This is a lie.
The Arrow program will not be canceled.
The right stuff, the wrong time. The Arrow, December 28th.
I dare you to go back there.
She's a free-spirited girl growing up in a small town.
What do you wear this for?
There's a touch of Lucifer in that child.
I'm always doing what other people say.
You never do what other people say.
Emily of New Moon premieres January 4th.
They're like blessings never seen. They're like visions in a dream.
Tom Jackson, former pool room gambler, has found a home in Calgary and professional success.
You won't find too many business people as convicted in a meeting as he is. He'll walk into that room and people flip open their checkbooks. And nobody says no to him.
I'm calling from the Huron Carroll office in Calgary, and I'd like
that's
to check
the
on
$600 if we go that direction.
Tom and Allison own three nightclubs, produce television and theater, raise money for literacy, sponsor a theater school, and are planning a mobile soup kitchen. But half their time and energy is devoted to the Christmas and Winter Relief Association and the Huron Carroll.
Yeah. On our first meeting, we made a deal. I asked her, I said, what do you want to do, you know, with your life? And she said, I want to make $1 million. And she owned a clothing store at the time. And she said, what do you want to do with your life? And I said, I want to change the world. And I said, I'll make you a deal. I said, I'll show you how to make $1 million if you help me change the world. And we shook hands. That was our bond. And to this day, it's the one thing that we can rely upon for one another, that that's what we want to do.
Hey, there's an extra large. There's a poster. That's $25.
The humble show that was born at the Silver Dollar Room now travels across Canada, generating millions of dollars in contributions and donated food. The boy who slept in stairwells has been Canadian chairman of UNICEF and the recipient of a dozen humanitarian awards.
When all the birds had slept, that mighty Kitchimanitou sent angel choirs instead. Before their light, the stars grew dim. Wandering hunters.
It's an elation. It's an addiction. It's something that once you experience, you can't get enough of. For me, the gift was in the giving. I don't do this for a hobby. This is what I do for a living. This is what my lifeblood is all about.
The earliest moon of winter time is not so round and fair.
Tom Jackson says that his mission will end the day no one goes homeless or hungry.
The chiefs from far before him knelt.
At the top of his profession, he has chosen to reach out, to offer a carol of hope, not with his voice, but with his heart.
Jesus is born.
I'd like to be remembered as the guy who sang the song Here on Carol. Because the project has a life. And it has a life that'll go long after me. And it's all I want to be remembered as in respect to that as the guy who sang the song.
In excelsis gloria.
That's our show for tonight. Tom Jackson's Huron Carol concert will be broadcast in full Christmas Day on CBC. Life and Times will be back in January with more fascinating biographies. Here's a preview of what's coming up in the new year.
I am an educated chick. I have seen a lot of things.
Canada's most public political wife, Margaret Trudeau Kemper. Canada's daredevil skiers, the Crazy Canucks.
Look at that baby. He's more than a second ahead. He's having a great...
David Suzuki, today a renowned scientist and environmentalist. He had to struggle for acceptance.
I've been driven by the constant need to succeed.
Longshoreman turned movie actor Chief Dan George. And Air Farce, because they celebrate 25 years making Canadians laugh.
Life and Times, Fridays on CBC.
Please, ma'am, I want some more.
A new twist.
No, you don't. Better come with me, young lad.
On a Dickens classic.
We're your family now.
Disney's Oliver Twist, Monday at 8.
For a spoonful of sugar, help some medicine go down.
Mary Poppins.
Relive the magic. Julie Andrews and Dick Van Dyke. A movie special, Mary Poppins, Christmas Day.
Here, in the world's most advanced manufacturing environment, Intel technicians are making Pentium 2 processors. It's the most powerful Intel processor available today. So to make sure the Pentium 2 processor is inside your next PC, look for this logo on the outside.
People can't believe it.
We have thousands of blinds and shades to choose from.
Made to measure at factory direct prices.
When I tell them their options, 20,000 styles and colors to choose from. They get this look on their face.
Like kids in a candy store.
Their order's ready so fast, they're shocked.
She's shocked.
This is the new way to shop for blinds.
Fast, really fast.
We should get a drive-thru.
You have windows.
We have blinds. We have shades. And that's all we have.
Blinds to go now with 7 superstores in the Greater Toronto Area. Visit our newest location on Dundas West.
Call to order Rogers MeTV now and you could win a trip to historic England.
I'm so into history.
Or one of 10 Sony home theaters. There's over $300,000 in prizes, including a grand prize of $50,000. The earlier you enter, the more chances to win. And with 16 channels for as little as $5.99, you can't lose. Order MeTV today to win. Call 1-888-ROGERS-1.
It's the E.I. Williams Spurt Boxing Day Now Sale, starting December 19th. Why wait till Boxing Day to buy the finest European designs? Givenchy, Sebastiano, Billy J, Emilio, at guaranteed low prices of 50 to 70% off with a 5-year warranty. Hey, no GST or PST plus 10% cash back. E.I. Williams open daily Monday through Sunday, 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. One location only, 170 Esper Park at Denison in Markham.
It's hard to surprise people during the holidays. So shop at Business Depot. Give them something different, like the Casio 256K Organizer, a Microsoft Force Feedback Joystick, or the Tagus Notepad. Business Depot. Great gifts for all, for less.
You know, aunts spend a lot of time working, and seeing as their jobs take them out on the road, it'd sure be convenient to carry ClearNet PCS phones. But they don't, because they don't know how affordable it is. Which is too bad, because they could use it to warn each other about occupational hazards. Like this Bob guy here. Ouch. ClearNet PCS, with airtime way more affordable than cellular, no contracts assigned, and a 30-day satisfaction guarantee. Yep, it's finally time to get a wireless phone.
Bill Clinton heads for Bosnia. Nuclear-friendly zone.
You want it here?
A small town fights for its reactor. And mail call.
Where's it going?
To Santa Claus.
But will it get there by Christmas?
Sunday Report with Noreen Burgess.
Good evening. A strategic mission to Bosnia for U.S. President Bill Clinton. He'll be visiting American soldiers who won't be coming home anytime soon. And he's taking along an important ally to shake off criticism of his decision to keep American troops there. Here's Red Sharon.
Just days after deciding to keep U.S. troops in Bosnia indefinitely, Bill Clinton is heading there himself. And wife Hillary and daughter Chelsea won't be his only company. Republican Bob Dole is on board, too, in more ways than one. He supports the president's decision to keep troops there past the June pullout date, and his presence on this trip is seen as an attempt to silence critics.
Well, it's going to go into chaos when we leave, whether it's tomorrow or 6 months from now or 10 years from now. In the meantime, we're spending two and a half.